morning for America, good afternoon in Europe, and good evening in Asia. Thank you so much to attend this CRSA webinar about esophageal surgery. It's a pleasure for me to have the possibility by the society to organize this very interesting meeting on a topic that I work in this surgical field about a lot of years. So it's a pleasure, it's an honor for me to have the this possibility by CRSA. Thank you, Professor Giulianotti, Professor Macido, Professor Urda and Professor Pernazza to attend the meeting with you, your cooperation. It's very important to respect the time in order to leave some time for the questions at the end of the presentations. So I introduce myself with the first presentation about the technical steps on robotic surgery. I share the screen. I can start my presentation. Disclosures and topics of my presentation. My disclosures, I think we can go forward. The technical steps, I focused the attention on technical step because I think is a very important topic for robotic esophagectomy to know, to focus the technical step, starting by the positioning, ports, docking of the robot, and other important topics about the dissection, the anastomotic techniques, and other steps, for example, particular situation, including intraoperative difficult situation. Patient cart and port positioning. We use a full robotic procedure, so we use the robot both in the chest and in the abdomen. We use a five port technique in the chest, using the fourth arm also in the chest, and we use a semi-prone position. I think there are some reasons that you can see in the slide, faster positioning of the patient in comparison with a complete prone position, more space to put the ports for the four robotic arms, possibility to avoid even in a semi-prone position a single lung ventilation and a faster conversion in case of emergency. You can see the docking of the robot from the left side of the patient, and the we have the possibility, as explained before, to use double or single lung ventilation also in a semi-prone position. So usually we honestly we use a single lung ventilation, but for specific cases or specific phases of the operation, we use also the double lung ventilation in semi-prone position, using six or seven millimeter of pneumothorax to collapse the lung to achieve a good vision. And in the abdomen, same technique, full robotic procedure, five ports, four arms used. Why the robot in the abdomen? I think we can have Technical advantages using the robot in the abdomen, for example, for lymph node dissection, I think easier in comparison with standard laparoscopy, especially for cancer of cardia requiring a more lymph node dissection in the abdomen. The bleeding control may be easier. Also, advantages in obese patients in doing the jejunostomy, and finally, for ergonomics of the surgeon, I think esophagectomy may be a longer procedure, time-consuming, so for the surgeon may be very tiring. And so the robot may improve the ergonomics of surgeon. This is the docking of the XI system from the right side of the patient. We put the robot in the same position at the beginning of the operation, is the same for thoracic and abdominal step. The use of the fourth arm, I think, is very important. The use of the fourth arm in every kind of robotic surgery, we have to learn the use of the robotic fourth arm because it's very incredible the helping, the assistance that surgeon may have by the correct use of the fourth arm. You see in the abdomen to retract the liver, to expose the hiatal space, but also in the chest. With the previous generation of robots, the use of the four arms in the chest probably was more difficult, but I think with the XI system, it's very easy to put four robotic arms also in small spaces, in small chest, even in small patients. So I think it's very important to learn the use of the fourth arm. It's very important to use it in our kind of surgery. Mediastinal dissection, we have divided the mediastinal dissection in three steps. The first one, we start operation opening the space between the pericardium and distal esophagus, distal thoracic esophagus. We cut the inferior pulmonary ligament. We expose the pericardium going up to the vena azygos. This is the first step. It's a very easy dissection usually because it's a very simple plane, the space between pericardium and the esophagus. We go up to the vena azygos, and we come back below. We come back below, coming to the diaphragm along the descending aorta, removing the lymphatic infected tissue around the esophagus, and you see perfectly the mesoesophagus after the first dissection posterior between pericardium and the esophagus. We open very well the space, and we can cut the mesoesophagus, and we can see also in the other video the transection of the mesoesophagus using advanced energies like the vessel sealer device. And finally, after this, on the hand, at the end of these steps, we close the thoracic duct just above the diaphragm. It's not mandatory to remove in every case the thoracic duct, but usually we expose thoracic duct and we close. You see also the lymph node dissection on the left side of the inferior mediastinum. You see the contralateral pleura, the left pleura, and the removal of the left lymphatic tissue, and finally the closure of the thoracic duct. The second step is the preparation and transection of azygos vein. The lymphadenectomy on the carina and the section of a right bronchial artery. The azygos vein is prepared in cut. We cut using a stapling device. We have used also ligation or amoloc, but honestly, we have a real risk of amoloc to produce a lesion on the pars flaccida of the trachea or of the bronchus. So there are reports of migration of amoloc inside the trachea. So we have stopped the use of amoloc for azygos vein, and we prefer to transect by stapler. We complete the lymphadenectomy below the carina, around the origin of the left and right bronchus, and you have seen the transection of right bronchial artery. And finally, the upper mediastinum, we complete the dissection on the upper mediastinum, in particular in right side in Barrett's area, removing the lymph nodes on the right side of the trachea, and completing the mobilization of the esophagus up to the superior thoracic inlet. We remove the nodes. We can do a perfect lymph node dissection when indicated up to the epiaortic vessels. You see the cleaning also on the left side along the left laryngeal nerve. This is very interesting, this dissection, because in thoracoscopy may be difficult to reach this area. In poor surgeon is very no ergonomics situation. So I think even in this case, robot can have some advantages for surgeon. For abdominal steps, we complete we do a complete gastrolysis, we mobilize the stomach, and we prepare the gastric conduit, doing also Cocker maneuver, lymph node dissection. You see also in fatty patients, the dissection may be easy. We can control perfectly the potential bleeding. I think this is an important technical advantage of the robot, because using the fourth arm, we have a perfect exposure. With the assistant surgeon, we have a continuous cleaning of the operating field. So in case of bleeding, surgeon has more possibility to control also difficult bleeding, avoiding an open conversion. I think we can go forward, because the time is very limited in transection of the left gastric artery. Okay. The preparation of the mediastinum, also the dissection inside the mediastinum may be easier by the hiatus, because with this kind of robot it's possible to do a dissection up to the neck, and it's possible to do a lymphadenectomy, a transhiatal lymphadenectomy up to the carina. We open just a minimum the hiatus in order to achieve a better vision, in order to have a good space to translate the gastric conduit. And finally, We check the conduit by Indochinin Green. We complete the transection of the stomach in Ivor Lewis. This is an Ivor Lewis preparation, and we complete by injection of botulinum in the pylorus and doing the jejunostomy. About the Ivor Lewis, I can go forward about the theoretical assumptions of the Ivor Lewis. Is a, I think, a surgical technique to know very well for cancer of cardia or distal esophagus. May be very difficult to do a complete, a fully minimally invasive Ivor Lewis, a very demanding technique, especially for the intrathoracic anastomosis. We have standardized the intrathoracic anastomosis using the linear stapler you see on the right video. In the left video, you see the previous technique, Enthune anastomosis. We started using the technique, the Enthune technique, and during the years we have changed in favor of stapling anastomosis. In this case, we put two stitches to approach the gastric conduit to the esophagus. We recheck by injection of Indochinin Green in the during the thoracic surgical step, and we do a gastrotomy very distant from the stapler line of the gastric conduit. You see the stapler line is very posterior. We do a gastrotomy at a distance most of the two or three centimeters by stapler line. And finally, we put the robotic stapler. I think robotic stapler is very helping for this anastomosis because the assistant surgeon may be very difficult, measure difficult to put correctly the linear stapler inside the esophagus because the space to maneuver the stapler is very small between the in the intercostal spaces, so the use of the robotic stepper improved our ability to perform this kind of anastomosis, and we close using the lock shooter. Better results in our experience: reduction of drastic reduction of leakage, also of anastomotic stricture. Probably we have a lot of reflect of motivation of better results. I think in general probably the Oehringer technique reduce the stricture. This is the same results of the anastomosis in the neck. But I think using this technique we can reduce the force of the on the anastomosis because we have two stitches that reduce the tension between inside the anastomosis because we put two stitches between esophagus and gastric conduit. We have a longitudinal linear anastomotic line by the stepper, and finally a transverse line by the closure of the running shooter. So I think probably we have a distribution of the forces in more directions, and probably the results finally are better than a simple Enthune anastomosis. This is my opinion. Probably there is another problem of the position of gastrotomy using the Enthune anastomosis. we have to put the gastrotomy very posterior, but this is in some cases difficult because the vision is not so good posterior on the posterior surface of the gastric conduit. We can discuss this topic at the end of the meeting. And finally, other topics, just 1 minute and I conclude my presentation. In the abdomen, for example, the preservation of the left hepatic artery, a major left hepatic artery from the gastric after chemotherapy in obese patient may be very difficult in laparoscopy. In the chest, you see a complete opening of the left bronchus caused by the balloon of the Callens tube, and we were able to repair the damage, the injury, using a robotic suture. Also, this procedure may be difficult in standard thoracoscopy. Thank you so much for the attention. The next speaker is Dr. Urda. So please, Yael, thank you to attend the meeting. It's a pleasure to see you after a lot of months. I hope to see in Tuscany in the next future. Please, Yael.
Good to see you. And I loved your presentation, Andrea. It's really nice. But your technique is very, very similar to what we're doing in Utrecht. And so many technical details that we could talk about for hours, but we should do that on the next occasion. I focused on locally advanced disease, and pleasure to be invited by CRSA. It's an honor to be here. And we started with robotic surgery already in 2000 in Utrecht. And then from 2003 on, we started doing esophagectomies. And we did together with Richard, most of you will know Richard van Hillegersberg, we did over 600 procedures now. All our esophagectomies are robotic. So Transiadol, Ivor Lewis, McEwen, all of them. We trained and proctored a lot of centers. And I think one of the main things, and you already pointed that out, is that you have to do it very structured and very, very stepwise. And there are at least 200 steps, is what Richard always told me in this procedure. But you have to make it simple for yourself. So very structured, as you just showed us. And if you make it that easy and you do every case with the robot, you'll find that it has a definitive role in locally advanced disease. And we do this very standard. We published a robot trial, which is our standard population. And because I had to talk about advanced, in that robot trial, over 80% is over T3 and N positive. So that already is advanced disease. And in those patients, we demonstrated robot-assisted esophagectomy to be safe and with oncologic outcomes similar to open surgery. And as you all know, faster recovery after surgery. So we've proved it. We standardize it, but it remains a technical challenging procedure with all the factors that you already showed us. Aorta, trachea, heart, pulmonary veins, all are very close. It's always moving all the time. So the robot really helps you to do it. And if you do it very structured and always the same, you can use it in very difficult cases. And that's what I'm going to talk about for the rest of this lecture, because we're going to talk about first, structuring, and second, advanced cases. Structuring starts with good training. Well, this is a course that we host in Utrecht, but there are many more of these courses, and it starts with good training, case observation, and then find a good proctor that can help you to get this going, and then standardize your procedure. Well, I won't go into detail because you already did, but divide it into simple steps, and we've published this. You can look it up, both for the thoracic part and for the abdominal part. And I think it's 90% the same as you describe it, Andrea. So it's standardized, reproducible, easy. We teach our fellows like this, and it's always the same. And you can look this up. It's also on web. You can freely access it step by step. And if we talk about structured procedures, you move on to advanced disease. And with advanced, I mean two things. One is salvage surgery. So that's after definitive chemo radiotherapy with T4B tumors connected to the trachea, the aorta, or the pericardium. But the second thing is also extended lymph node dissections. And there are a couple of topics with those lymph node dissections. And one is abdominal extended, so D3 with para-aortic lymph nodes, but also the upper mediastinum and even in the neck region. And the last part I'll touch on is contralateral lymph nodes in the chest. So I'll show you some examples. It's of course anecdotal because you don't see these patients too much, but I have some nice examples of how the robot can help you in these advanced cases. First of all, a T4 tumor. And in T4 tumors, standard treatment in most centers will be definitive chemo radiotherapy. But we all know that the results are very poor. Local regional failure in more than 50%, 3-year survival of only 20 to 25%. And if they fail, they get perforations, they get serious problems. So what we do now, standard, and we discuss it in our MBT, that patients with a T4 tumor get treated by an extended course of chemo radiotherapy. So that's cross plus 1 week. And then we follow them up at 3 months. We restage them with PET, EBUS, or EUS, depending on where the tumor is. And then, if possible, we will resect them. It's very hard to restage those patients, and that's why we more and more use MR-based techniques as well to restage them. So this is one of the patients I recently operated, 72-year-old male, squamous cell cancer. And it was T4B because, and you can see my arrow, I hope, because it was connected to the left main bronchus. EBUS showed ingrowth into the muscular layer. And then we restaged him. And after there was no persisting ingrowth, we did surgery on him. And in this patient, it ended up to be a T2N1 with a radical resection. And we have a series of about 20 patients that we recently published on this, and all but one were radical in that series. But this is extremely challenging, and I'll show you that in the next movie. And to make sure that you understand what you're looking at, trocar placement is the same as you do. It's a bit more semicircular than a straight line to create a bit more space in the chest, but it's more or less a straight line of ports. And it's a semi-prone position. And that you need to know that because otherwise you don't understand the image you're looking at. So the patient's belly is front and we're looking at the upper mediastinum here. This here is the cava, the superior caval vein. This is the trachea. And you can see after a long course of chemo radiotherapy, it's very inaccessible, much harder to recognize proper planes, and you see all this whitish tissue, and you just hope, and you take frozen samples, that it's not tumor. The pathologist usually cannot help you because they don't know either at that stage, but you just try to peel it off the trachea. This is the right main bronchus, this is the upper part, and here's the lower part of the right main bronchus, and you can see here the ingrowth of the tumor, the whitish tissue. But if you approach it step by step, you can see even that the membranous part is retracted up here. So this is the membranous part. It goes up towards that process here. And you do this, it's nerve-wracking surgery, where you stay away from the membranous part. Otherwise, you have to do a repair. And Andrea just showed that you can do it, but you'd rather not do it. And then you just peel it off that trachea, step by step. And the fourth arm really helps. I agree totally with what Andrea said on that, because you have to provide yourself traction and counter traction. And here in these images, the counter traction is provided by gravity, but your two arms will help to lift the esophagus and provide that counter traction. And then if you peel it up gently, this is the left main bronchus, and you can see there's a balloon in it. This is the right main bronchus, and you can see how the attachment is. But if you go step by step, you'll peel it off, and this whitish tissue will come away from that trachea. And you rely on that EBUS to make sure that you don't go through the tumor. Actually, it's pretty reliable, as you can read in that paper that I just shared with you. Another lymph nodes in the aorta pulmonary window there. And like this, you can even operate on these T4 tumors. I wouldn't start here because it's really nerve-wracking and you can easily go into the trachea. But if you do every case robotic, you'll find that the robot helps you. The stability of the image, the ability to zoom in, and like this, you just isolate the problem here and you get the esophagus out. Usually these T4 on the trachea are squamous, so they respond pretty well to chemoradiotherapy. And usually they're also fixed on the aorta at the same spot. And that's what makes it difficult because they don't lift that easily. So you really have to be very gentle and go step by step. That was the first example. I have another example of a T4. I operated her last December. And this was a T4, and that we had a small suspicion based on this CT scan, because you can see the irregularity here at the pulmonary vein and on the atrium. And then we did an EUS, and they confirmed ingrowth into that atrium. Again, we did extended cross, and then, of course, you cannot really restage it. We do EUS, and we do another CT scan, and then we just explore it. And that's this exploration. And this is the inferior pulmonary ligament. Here is the right pulmonary vein. And this is what happens pretty often, is that you peel a bit of pericardium off that pulmonary vein, which is tricky because you can easily be one layer too deep. Now, there was no problem here at the right pulmonary vein, but you'll see when we move on over the pericardium, and with the robot, you're always sure that you're exactly in the right plane. Really, you operate at microscopic detailed level, so millimeter by millimeter. And in this, once again, widest tissue, you go and you go step by step and just peel this tumor off the heart and then off the pulmonary vein. You can see the infiltration caused by the radiotherapy. And you can also see that it doesn't lift too easily. Also caused by the spine of this lady, but also because it's still stuck. It's still a bit stuck on that pericardium. But step by step, you can peel this off and you move on. This was a complete responder, but with nodal positivity. So it was a T-North N1 disease after resection. Of course, you would love to know if there is a complete response beforehand, but I still don't know a good way of finding that out. And this is the area where you go towards the left pulmonary vein. And that's, of course, where it gets tricky. And you make sure you isolate it from both sides and then you peel it off. So another example of advanced disease. And these are two T4 tumors. And I also have some extended lymph node dissections that I have some movies of. This is the first one, 68-year-old male. And there was this lymph nodes, paratracheal in station 2. We punctured it with EUS and it was tumor positive. So in such a case, what we would do is irradiate the full mediastinum, so including all those lymph nodes. And then, because we don't want to make an anastomosis in such a mediastinum, we would do a McEwen procedure, including a lymph node dissection. And this is the upper mediastinum. Here we look at, we still place clips on that azygos vein. And I agree that it can be tricky. And what I always do is that I make sure that the gastric conduit is beneath the clip, so it doesn't lie on the trachea. And from here on, over the superior caval vein, we first take station 4 out. This is station 4. Everything lower caudal to the vagus nerve is station 4. We take that step by step. You have to be gentle. you take all the fat out and then suddenly the vein still bulges and it's bigger than you think. And step by step, you take that station out over the edge of the cava. And here's the trachea. And the thing is that you easily end up anterior to the trachea. There's not an anatomic landmark that you can use to stop your lymph node dissection. So sometimes you end up all the way past the trachea. So at a certain point, you have to say, this is it. And if you move on, you'll find this is vagus nerve, and this is an anterior branch of that vagus nerve. And I always try to preserve them because they might give some cardiac arrhythmias if you leave them in. And like this, step by step, I clear separately station 4, and then station 2 will be a separate lymph node dissection, because you want to, I try to spare that vagus nerve and also the vagus branches towards the lung. So this is still intact, and here are some vagal branches towards the lung. This is the right main bronchus. And in this way, you clear station 4. And then if you go above that vagus nerve, you'll find more lymph nodes, but also the recurrent nerve. Because if you look a bit more up, you'll see the subclavian, this is already the recurrent nerve in this patient. But you'll find the subclavian vein and the subclavian artery, and you can follow this step by step and make sure that you preserve that nerve here. I'm always very gentle, try to avoid to use too much energy close to it. I operate this guy end of February and his voice is good. So I was pretty happy because it can be, even the traction that you put on that recurrent nerve can cause hoarseness. And usually it's temporary, because I must say you never really cut it, but you sometimes damage it and give some neuropraxia on that nerve. So this is vagus again, and there it recurs towards the neck, and all these lymph nodes can be taken out. There are also some branches always going, small branches, but it's really at microscopic level that connect to the esophagus. And those branches, of course, you have to cut, like this one. And here you can see we're really at the level of the thoracic aperture. And if you open the neck after this dissection, it's already completely freed up. You really do a partial neck dissection from the chest. So like this, we make sure that we preserve the nerve and step by step do a full lymph node clearance. Try to use neurostimulation. Didn't find it was too useful, because you can rely on your eyesight pretty much. And I think that's more reliant than the neurostimulation. But some people use it and they're happy with it. And like this, you go on and clear that full mediastinum. Another one, this is a cervical node, and I'll be short on this one because I want to show you this recurrent nerve dissection on the left side. So we look at the same image. This is the vagus, cava is there, here is the stump of the zygus, and here we go over the trachea. So the trachea with the membranous part is here. And then if you open this, and there's always a small fascia there, and if you open that fascia, you'll see the recurrent nerve. And here it is. I can already see it, but if the hook goes out of the way, you'll see it as well. So there's the recurrent nerve. And if you see it like this, so you can preserve it. So you make sure that you give it full exposure, and then you move on and go to the dorsal side and expose the aortic arch. And here the left pleura, the duct is resected en bloc with the specimen. And you clear everything here as much as possible. And then if you clear that, you'll lift the paratracheal nodes up and you'll look from the other side again and see that recurrent nerve and do that full mediastinal lymph node dissection on that left station 2 and 4 as well. And I tried this with conventional instruments, but your image is always moving. Your instruments are always deep in. So it's very hard to do this in a precise way. And I think the robot really here helps us to do a proper dissection and to really go to the limit to get every node out. And that might not be necessary in every patient, but patients with proven paratracheal lymph nodes, I think we should always try to get those lymph nodes out. And here again, so from the other side, trachea is here. The vagus was just before the trachea. And here we open that compartment and the recurrent nerve now stays below. There it is, that's the top. That's a recurrent nerve, and we clear everything of it. Looking at the time, but we're already a bit ahead, so I'll move forward and show you the last. This is the last movie I had, and it's someone I did last week, so that's why I was very enthusiastic about it. Prior to chemo radiotherapy, we had this PET scan with contralateral left-sided nodes on the aorta. And what we did, and my fellow is operating here, so you'll see me point every now and then, but this is the aorta from the other side. This is the inferior pulmonary ligament, so that's on the other side of your image, and this is the diaphragm. And here we do the exact same thing, so we open the inferior pulmonary ligament and get this node out. And so this is, one second. So this is what it looks like. And here is the pericardium from that side. This is where you'll find the pulmonary vein. And in this way, and I'm pointing out where he needs to go now, in this way, we clear that whole mediastinum of the lymph nodes. And of course, I realize that this is very extensive disease. So what we do, we resect this node, treat the patients with chemo radiotherapy, and then restage. And if possible, we will do a resection. In the last 5 years, I did 3 patients like this. And one of them is 3 years post-surgery and still no evidence of disease. So I think, of course, it's a bad prognosis, but in some cases with a young and fit patient, you can really try to move and to move curative treatment further, I hope. Well, and that's the posterior side on the aorta. And what you will always find here is a lot of lymphatics on the left side. We never approach it, but all 3 previous patients to this one had a chylothorax post-surgery. So now I'm very secure that I clip every small chylus branch here. And this patient did well and is now in his chemo radiotherapy, started this Monday. So, well, I hope that was a bit instructive of what you can do if you standardize a procedure that you can really extend your indications to T4 disease and extensive lymph node disease. And I would encourage you to do it very structured and very stepwise. Thank you, Andrea.
Thank you, Yael. Thank you very much for this very nice, interesting presentation. I hope we have the possibility to discuss some topics at the end of our webinar this afternoon. Thank you again. I introduce now Professor Giulianotti. It's a pleasure, an honor for me to introduce my master. I started my experience in general surgery and in robotic surgery with Piero, so it's a real pleasure to introduce you, Piero, with the presentation about the treatment of giant and recurrent hiatal hernias. Please, Piero, thank you again to stay with us to attend the meeting.
Hello, everybody, and thank you. I confess that I enjoyed both presentation, your presentation, and also Dr. Urda presentation, fantastic. And of course, it's such a complex topic to speak about esophageal surgery. There are so many details that probably we should in the future organize monothematic webinars discussing tricks because I saw some dissection, a beautiful dissection in the upper mediastinum, discussing about laryngeal nerves, sophisticated and difficult lymphonodal stations in the upper mediastinum. And there are so many different techniques for, say, preservation of the vocal cords, functionality, nerve monitoring, Japanese styles, the dissection of the lymph nodes. And so just to mention some of the controversial, difficult topic. As far as my topic, this is another, I think, a very controversial issue, how we treat gigantic paraesophageal herniation. And I just prepared a very basic presentation because I understand being involved in training fellows and students that there are a lot of wrong concepts in the diagnosis and the treatment of this condition. Let's say, first of all, a controversial issue, what is gigantic? Because many people is probably confusing simple hiatal hernia. And in my opinion, gigantic is when you have at least 50%, majority accept 30%, but in my opinion, gigantic when you have at least 50% of the stomach inside the chest. I don't want to spend time about speaking about the symptoms, but to remind that we have to clearly divide this condition in different types. And I think type one is the sliding hernia. It's not the the topic of today. And also let me say type two hernias, it's very rare that we are treating type two hernias. Usually type two is the beginning of a paraesophageal herniation. And but before patients, they're becoming really symptomatic. Usually this condition is advancing to type three, and that is the large majority of gigantic herniation that we are treating are this type. And of course, type four, when you have other organs, the colon, omentum in small bowel, and even I remember a complex case that was one of the few converted case in open that I did probably more than 10 years ago, was a gigantic paraesophageal containing spleen and the distal pancreas. That was impossible to reduce this hernia, minimal invasive, and they had to convert into a thoracofrenal left access. Diagnostic, again, it's a very long topic and I want to spend much time here, but saying that basically endoscopy, barium swallow, and the CT scan are the foundation of the diagnosis. Manometry, of course, you might add some functional information, but it's difficult. You have the stomach and the displacement of the gastroesophageal junction with different thoracic pressure. Honestly, I don't rely much on the formation of manometry. As far as the surgical treatment, we can clearly differentiate three different situations. emergency treatment when you have a complication of this gigantic herniation. And I have to say that I have personal experience of a really emergent surgery for perforation of a volvolized colon inside the chest or necrosis of the stomach requiring a total gastrectomy. That's, of course, it's an indication for surgery, but not necessarily all situations can be managed minimally invasive. One of the cases that I mentioned that required the subtotal colectomy for perforation of the colon inside the chest had to be converted open. Elective, probably the larger majority of indication are elective cases with patients that they have some kind of symptoms and they can be different kind of symptoms that you may afraid that this could be a beginning of a more complicated situation like incarceration. And if the patient is a candidate for or there are no contraindications for anesthesia, I think this is the elective situation. As far as prophylaxis, I think the concept is changing. Even my opinion, I reviewed a case with almost no symptoms with gigantic herniation, and I'm very flexible. Of course, if you're dealing with a patient age 90, and no way of offering surgery in this situation, but if you have a young patient with a gigantic herniation, even without a few symptoms or no symptoms, I am in favor of doing surgery. Complication, they might happen. I already mentioned that. Very quickly, because I would like, we are in late, we would like to show open surgery, of course, the classical treatment. We know that there are drawbacks and complications, long operative stay, minimal invasive treatment is, of course, emerging, but there are difficulties of the laparoscopy in mainly in doing the dissection inside the mediastinum. There is one thing that is clear anyway, this based on literature reviews and also our own experience that utilization, proper utilization of meshes to reinforce the reconstruction of the hiatus is decreasing the incidence of recurrence. As far as comparison laparoscopy and robotics, still we don't have a real randomized studies to prove, but is there is a mass of data that are emerging progressively and that the robotic platform is increasing the technical abilities of mediastinal dissection, not only for the esophagectomy, as you clearly showed in the presentation, earlier presentation, but also for this condition. So in particular, some redo cases or complex hernia with reflux and also is benefiting and also probably the learning curve is less. Another controversial issue, and I hope that it will be a spark for a discussion to define what is a recurrence for a gigantic herniation, because even there is a modification of the conformation of the diaphragm. And so based only on radiology, you might have the impression that few centimeters of the fundus are inside the chest. In reality, it's not a true recurrence. So it's a very controversial issue, speaking about recurrence. And there is also a discrepancy in between recurrence on symptoms and recurrence of radiology. These patients are not easy to follow. at least in the United States, and some of the patients that are doing well are completely lost to the follow-up. And this is another confusing factor, and the population of patients that you keep seeing in the clinic usually are the worst candidates for that kind of follow-up. This is just a drawing to explain some of the the changes that we are doing with the operation. I'm speeding up because I would like to go to some technical steps here because I think I modified my technique, and as Dr. Rurda clearly stated for esophagectomy, we need to proceed in a very organized way and with clear steps that can be produced, and they can facilitate the conduction of the operation. For example, a majority of surgeons still are suggesting to start from the right pillar or the diaphragm. That, in my opinion, is totally wrong, because you on the right pillars, you have the stretching of the gastrohepatic ligament with the, all the vagal fibers that are going to the liver, gallbladder, and also you're in 20% of cases, you have accessory left hepatic artery that can be damaged. It's not the easy starting point. If you have a good traction with your assistant and of the stomach down, and you can really slide on the left pillar and start detaching the gastric fundus from the hernia sac from the left pillar. And also a concept that I would like to reiterate and during this presentation is that you don't need to detach the entire hernia sac. This is, I think, it's a wrong statement that it's easy if it's a small, let's say, type 2 hernia to resect this. But if you are going to gigantic and you are seeing a patient really with the cavity in the mediastinum that is almost big as the abdominal cavity, and this might expand to the left or to the right chest. To try to resect all the hernia sac is difficult. You might open the pleura bilaterally. You can have bleeding. And then you have all this redundant tissue that is not allowing you to make a good reconstruction. And you have to resect and you get lost in the anatomy. So I think a resection of the entire sac, it's an old wrong concept. Let's start with a few examples, and I will speed up the video. So when you are pulling down the stomach and you are helping your assistant, and then your assistant with two hands and has to keep some tension, traction and counter traction, and it's easy to slide on the left pillar. Then you're entering to the mediastinum, and you do the detachment of the left side of the gastric fundus and the distal esophagus. And it's easy to recognize the vagus here, you see there, and to make a dissection as much as you can. And then, you go and on the right side of the mediastinum, and you are doing a kind of anti-reverse clockwise dissection. You start from the left pillar, left mediastinum, then you do the right side dissection of the sac. The concept is that you have to make a cylindric detachment of the esophagus and the stomach from the hernia sac, ignoring the remaining part of the sac. Then when you have a good window, you pass in a Penrose and behind, and this at this point, the rest is much easier because you're making a good traction and on the esophagogastric junction, and you are able to free up the posterior part at this point, the dissection on the right crust. And you can see the structure. You might avoid opening the pleura, and you have a good mobilization of the distal esophagus. You see the anterior vagus here, and you have to be sure that the mobilization of the esophagus, this is the both vagal nerves that are preserved. And then when you have done a complete mobilization, you do the chloroplasty, and it depends. Usually it's very compliant, the diaphragm, so you can close, don't tie too much because you can cut the fibers, eventually you can use some pledges, and then you tailor the mesh around the mesh. It can be very well spread, and you have to be sure not to tie too much the hiatus, because this is a reason of persistent dysphagia. If you have any doubt, you can put a bougie or a probe, but with experience, it's not necessary. The mesh has to be fixed very well. I confess that still I prefer the dual PTFE, even though there are other more recent meshes that can be used. I think I have very good experience and no erosions. The important that the edges of the mesh are not directly in contact with the esophagus, but still there are muscle of the iatroplasty that are in contact with the esophagus. And then the fundoplication, I confess that not always I do that, only patients that there are some history of reflux, and usually I prefer the toupee type and these, and also the both size of the wrap can be attached to the pillars and to the mesh and the diaphragm. So in some way is stabilizing, not only making an anti-reflux procedure, but also stabilizing the stomach. I don't like, and I usually I don't do gastrostomy stabilize because I think that fixing the stomach, if you have done a nice dissection of the esophagus with a complete detachment of the distal esophagus and the gastric fundus from the mediastinum, there is no need of gastrostomy for that. This is the concept of the cylindrical detachment of starting from the left side and in anti-clockwise fashion, dissection on the left side of the esophagus, right side, cylindrical detachment of the hernia sac, and a complete reduction of the stomach and the esophagus in the abdomen. I don't spend time with this. This is a strange situation. I think this probably, now this is a video. There are redo cases. I think we don't have time. Just to mention unusual cases, this was a Whipple that had a huge parasophageal herniation. So we had to do repair of the, because it was impossible to make the reconstruction of the digestive. So we had to do a repair of the parasophageal herniation and then the Whipple after that. I will try to stay in my time assigned and say our overall experience is probably around 80 gigantic parasophageal hernias. There is no mortality in the elective cases. We had three emergency cases. One was 89, a patient old with the perforation of the colon, the mediastinum, who died of sepsis and cardiac arrest. And after a week in the intensive care, that was an emergency surgery for perforation of the colon. And as far as recurrence rate, we are in the process of following up our patient with some difficulties because, as I mentioned, not all these patients are coming to the follow-up. And here, if you are prescribing MRI or CT scan for follow-up, a patient, they have some cost that they don't like to afford for the follow-up. But our so the average of a patient that we are able to follow is in the range of 60% of patient. That is not great for publishing paper. But in the patient that we are able to follow, the recurrence rate is minimal, is around 9-10%. That is comparing favorably with the best series. I think we for sure underevaluate the recurrence rate for the asymptomatic patients. The technique of robotic allows a very selective dissection. There are dogma that need to be overcome, like the total resection of the hernia sac. The cylindric detachment is probably the best technique. And the reinforcement with meshes is becoming a standard and need to be considered. And as far as revisional surgery is indicated in patients that have symptoms, but for radiological recurrence and patients are doing well, I think the strategy is a conservative follow-up. So I will stop here, and I hope there will be chances of more discussion.
Okay, thank you, Piero. Very nice presentation, very precise. I think we have a lot of topics to discuss inside the last phase of the webinar about technical steps, the use of mesh. There is a question for you in the chat about the need to do in every case the fundoplication or not in giant hernias. So we can discuss at the end of the webinar. So introduce the next speaker, Dr. Pernazza Graziano, dear friend, very good surgeon. We know we started together our experience in robotic surgery some years ago. So it's a pleasure to have you in this afternoon, Graziano. I introduce your presentation, robotic LR myotomy for achalasia, please.
Thank you, Andrea. There is a big friendship between us, so I'm very happy to join this webinar with my master, to Professor Giannotti, and we share more time at the beginning of our experience. So I'm very, very happy today. I will speak about the robotic treatment for achalasia. Just a quick focus on achalasia, which is a rare primary esophageal motility disorder, which is characterized by the loss of the lower esophageal sphincter relaxation and the absence of peristalsis of the esophageal body. It's important to focus on the diagnostic workup, in my opinion, because this is a rare disease, and the symptoms such as dysphagia, regurgitation, heartburn can be caused by many other disorders. And the consequence is that patients often experience a long delay between the onset of the symptoms and the diagnosis. So it's necessary to accurately study and correctly study these patients. So the first step is the clinical evaluation. And the use of the Eckhart score tool in our experience is very useful tool to assess the symptoms, to formulate the diagnosis, and to evaluate patients after the treatment. The second step, sometimes this is the first step, really is the esophagogastroduodenoscopy. There are characteristical findings, and the esophagogastroduodenoscopy with biopsy is necessary to rule out other forms or other pathologies or the pseudoachalasia, which is a condition caused by peptic stricture or cancer or giant hernia, for instance. Esophagogastroduodenoscopy is normal in one third of the patients, and the suspicion of achalasia is made by the presence of retained food in the esophagus, of dilated or tortuous esophagus, in presence of esophagitis that is caused by food stasis or infections more than gastroesophageal reflux, sorry, and the classic resistance to intubation of the esophagogastric junction is a typical sign in this kind of examination. Then the standard is the high-resolution esophageal manometry is actually the gold standard for the diagnosis of achalasia, and we can evaluate the peristalsis of the esophagus along a tube and to follow the bolus. This is an important tool, and we are considering the third edition of the Chicago classification. Now we know that has been recently published the fourth edition, but with this kind of examination we can stratify the achalasia into three kinds. Type 3 achalasia probably is the initial form of achalasia. We have an incomplete low esophageal relaxation with premature spastic and diffuse contractions. Then the type 2 achalasia probably is the second step in the progression of the pathology. We have incomplete relaxation of the less, aperistalsis, and the presence of panesophageal pressurization, and then the type 1 achalasia, which is an incomplete relaxation of the less, aperistalsis, and totally absence of esophageal pressurization. With this kind of HRM, with high resolution manometry, we found some patients with a typical syndrome, esophagogastric junction outflow obstruction, that is considered to be an initial form of achalasia. So it's important to perform this kind of diagnostic tool, the diagnostic exam, in experienced hands and with accurate stratification and classification of achalasia, because the classification is important in the evaluation of outcomes and in the choice of treatment. Then the fourth element in the diagnostic workup is the TBE, time barium esophagogram, not the standard esophagogram, because in this kind of exam we can evaluate the time the time of the esophageal outflow. So typical findings in achalasia are the narrowing of the esophageal gastric junction, the classic bird break or the tail of the mouse in Italian, a slow contrast emptying from the esophagus to the stomach, the airflow level because the contrast is stably into the esophagus, and the presence of tertiary contractions in of the esophagus in the type 2 achalasia. This kind of exam is useful to look for other associated pathology like epiphrenic diverticula, for example. Further investigation could be helpful, like CT scan in high-risk patients, in elderly and smokers, for the increased risk of cancer, and for the morphological study of the esophagus, like in this this case, when we have a sigmoid esophagus and we have to choose between myotomy and esophagectomy in some cases. There are no, sorry. There are no curative therapies for achalasia. We have to know that the treatment is palliative, focused on the resolution of symptoms, and its main goal is to eliminate the functional obstruction because we cannot recover the absence of peristalsis, improving the emptying of the esophagus into the stomach. The treatment options. We have currently different treatment options. Medical therapy is not durable and often is used to be a bridge to a more effective treatment. The botulinum toxin injection finds poor indication now. It was one of the first and easier tool through the injection of botulinum toxin at the esophagogastric junction. There is a high recurrence rate and it's necessary to provide retreatment in 6 or 7 months. And repeated treatment could make the Haller-Myotomy or other surgical procedure really more difficult with higher incidence of perforation and generally worse outcomes. So botulinum toxin injection is a tool that should be used only in patients with severe comorbidity who are not candidates for other more effective treatments. Pneumatic dilation is a good option, is indicated more in older in elder patients and in the female gender. And in the Chicago classification, it's considered useful in type 2 achalasia. There are a perforation, a low number of perforation, but it's present as a possible complication of this kind of treatment. Frequently, there is esophagitis in the follow-up of this kind of treatment, which is necessary to be repeated in the time, and the consideration is similar to the botulinum toxin injection. Repeated treatments may cause fibrosis around the esophagus and to make the intervention, the surgical procedure, more challenging and with not so good outcomes. Actually, the POIM is an interesting alternative to the surgical treatment. Is a peroral endoscopic myotomy. It was developed by Inoue in 2010, and other authors developed similar experiences with good success rates. But this procedure has a significant reflux symptomatology, even when we go to measure this reflux with the pH metry. So in the third edition of the Chicago classification, POEM is indicated only in type 3 achalasia. So in the initial form of achalasia, when the contraction of the esophagus is more extended, probably because with POEM it's possible to achieve a better myotomy in the proximal part of the esophagus. The drawback is the higher incidence of gastroesophageal reflux because in POEM is not possible to associate an anti-reflux surgery. But the long-term outcomes are considered similar between the Haller-Myotomy and the POEM. This is the Haller-Myotomy. These remain the standard treatment options. The standard extension of the myotomy is considered to be 6 centimeters on the esophageal side and 3 centimeters on the gastric side. And it's considered to it is considered necessary to provide the gastroesophageal reflux to prevent the gastroesophageal reflux after rheumatoidomy associating a DORF fund application. This is the first line treatment option in sigmoid esophagus versus esophagectomy, and this is considered the gold standard. It is not a new procedure because Heller developed this kind of procedure about 100 years ago. There were a lot of modification in the side of the myotomy. Heller proposed two myotomy, one anterior and one posterior. Then Zahir adjust the anterior. In 60, Dora proposed the association of fund application, transthoracic myotomy had poor outcomes. And in the 90s, at the early 90s, Shimi from the group of Koschieri developed the first minimally invasive option to perform other myotomy. And in the early 20s, Santiago Horgan and Scott Melvin developed the robotic approach to perform myotomy. Since the earlier experience was clear that robotic assisted surgery provided advantages through the 3D vision, the tremor filtration and motion scaling, allowing meticulous visualization and division of each muscle fibers because of the stability of the operative field and the tremor filtration and the precision in the management of the articulated instruments. As an effect, it was observed the decreasing in the number of esophageal perforation during myotomy in contrast with the perforation rate in laparoscopic surgery. And probably it was clear that with this approach, it was possible to reduce the learning curve for minimally invasive Heller myotomy. If you see in this column the mucosal injury, there is a significant difference between the laparoscopic series and the robotic one. This experience was repeated, and earlier experience showed the similar results. So we have a stable rate of perforation about 5-15% in the cases treated by laparoscopy, and a stable absence or a very, very low perforation rate in robotic surgery. Why robotic surgery can decrease the risk of mucosal tear or perforation during Heller myotomy? Probably because of the stability, because of the tremor filtration, probably it's possible through the articulation of the instruments. So when you are in laparoscopy, you have fixed the instruments, so you cannot orientate the hook on the fibers, while in robotic approach this is really easier. This is our experience. We refer to 35 patients, but I think it's important only to underline that our parameters are similar to what is present in the literature. This is the position of our system. We are continuing using an SI system, but I think and I hope we will move to the XI system in the next few weeks. And I would like to share with you of this procedure. The first step is the immobilization of the esophagogastric junction. I prefer to approach the right crus and then to section the peritoneal reflection on the anterior part of the esophagus. So then following the left crus to underpass the esophagus and to pass a small loop and to allow the assistant to retract the esophagus. This is useful for the second step, which is the myotomy. We start about 2 centimeters above the esophagastric junction, and you see that with the hook, it's possible to rotate the instruments and to perform easier the myotomy on the anterior part of the esophagus, going upwards and separating these fibers from the mucosa. Energy is low, and the application is very gentle, and we can divide fiber by fiber, proceeding millimeter by millimeter, and achieving a good exposure of the mucosal layer. We systematically use the hook, and we try to pass on the left side of the anterior vagus nerve, and we push the myotomy on the anterior part on the esophageal side for 5 or 6 centimeters, and then we move backward and we separate the fibers on the gastric esophagastric junction and then on the gastric wall. This is the more delicate part of the procedure, because a large proportion of the perforation occurred in this part of the dissection, so it's possible to have a traction by the assistant and a counter traction with the robotic forceps to better expose the fibers. Then when we finish the myotomy, the third part of the procedure is the check. Traditional check is the endoscopic one. It's useful in robotic console to follow the endoscopy and to see the operative field, and it's possible to check the endoscope through the part where we completed the myotomy. But we are moving to another kind of check. It's possible to see some incomplete fiber division, like in this small clip. But we are moving to another kind of check with the bougie on the esophagus, and then with the use of induction in green. We use an injection of 4 milliliters of ICG, and in my opinion, we can evaluate the perfusion and microperfusion of the mucosa, and so we can rule out any tear or perforation of these delicate layer, and check for incomplete fiber division, like in this part. And potentially, I think this tool may be possible to evaluate the micro ischemia of the mucosa, which is a risk factor for late perforation. So I think that this is a good innovation, a good tool to use in robotic surgery. Then the stitch is described by Heller to ligate the fundus of the stomach to the left crura and to the left part of the myotomy, the first stitch, the second one, and then we will place the third one, and we systematically conclude the procedure with an anterior fundoplication as described by Dorr. This is the third and last stitch, and complete the door application with this anterior stitch between the anterior wall of the stomach and the lateral part of the myotomy and the right so this is the last stitch of our procedure. And this is our perioperative protocol. We modified the approach described by Pallabhaser in 2019, and we are considering the systematic use of ICG green instead of endoscopy because of difficulties in organizing the endoscopy in the operating room, and because In our preliminary experience, we collected a series of 20 patients. We have encouraging results using the ICG green and the bougie. We eliminate the X-ray contrast swallow in the first postoperative day, but we provide immediately a liquid diet to the patient. And in second postoperative day, after a soft diet, the patients may be discharged. And we systematically follow up these patients with within 1 month with the symptoms evaluation and X-ray contrast swallow. Then after 6 months with esophagogastric duodenoscopy and another HR manometry, and yearly we continue to perform this examination. And we have actually more than 100 patients in follow-up. So this is a summary of the topics about the usefulness of robotic surgery in this kind of operation. In my personal opinion, robotic assistance allow to better standardize the procedure and as a consequence to improve the technical quality of the procedure. It's really amazing to isolate and section every fiber with the hook. And with the use of this kind of this tool of with the use of ICG, I think that potentially we can modify the perioperative management. So when we read in the literature that there is no difference between laparoscopy and robotic surgery, probably it depends, in my personal opinion, because we are continuing treating patients operated by robotic surgery in the same in the same way we treated patients operated in laparoscopy. I think it's similar to the ERAS concept in colorectal surgery, and ERAS allowed us to demonstrate the really weight of laparoscopy of minimally invasive surgery in colorectal in the colorectal field. So I think that probably technology is important when is able to modify not only the technical aspect of the intervention, but also the clinical pathway, the perioperative management of the patients. So I'm very happy. I hope to stay in the time. Thank you, Andrea. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Graziano. Why the video not start? Ah, okay. Thank you, Graziano. Very nice presentation. We can discuss some topics of your presentation at the end. I am interested in particular by the use of indocyanine green in this surgery. The next speaker, Dr. Antonio Macedo. Thank you, Antonio, to attend the meeting. It's a pleasure to have you with us this morning for you, this afternoon for me. Antonio will speak about robotic enucleation of benign or borderline esophageal lesions. Please, Antonio.
Thank you very much. I congratulate all of you because the nice and really good presentation. And since 2009, I use all my esophageal cancer treated with robot. I do all of my esophageal cancer with robotic surgery. I talk to you today about two cases referred to me with a benign lesion of the esophagus with a patient with a severe dysphagia. And I operated with the robot to remove the tumor. First case, it's a 50 years old woman with severe dysphagia, and in the CAT scanning, developed a huge tumor in the distal esophagus. Now we see You see, I operated with a Maryland bipolar, distal esophagus. You have the mediastinum just near the tumor. And I removed the tumor very careful to not to injure the mucosa. You see the aorta. Aorta really in the, in front of the tumor, and the pericardium in the posterior face of the tumor. So you nicely do the dissection with the robot without to injure the mucosa, because you can develop fistula. And you see it's very easy to remove. You do very gentle movements, nice, really very careful. And it's very easy to remove. You see, now you have the mucosa near the tumor, and you take very careful movements not to injure the mucosa. You see a tumor in the distal esophagus. Very easy to remove with the robot. Now you see the dissection in front. The mucosa is not injured. The leiomyoma is completely removed. Now we are finishing the muscle dissection. You can do the dissection with the scissor, with the hook, or with the Maryland bipolar. This patient was a patient taking anticoagulants for the problem of heart. You remove the specimen, and then I put stitches between the muscles to protect the mucosa. So it's very easy to put the stitches in this region with the robot. You can see putting stitches very careful between the muscles. It's a really nice presentation because the robot is so easy to manipulate in this region. Patient in semi-prone position and without one intubation. You see, very easy to put the stitches to protect the mucosa. This patient was discharged in the next day of the procedure in no more dysphagia, 6 months after the procedure. She developed a cholecystitis and was operated with a cholecystectomy, robotic cholecystectomy, after this surgery. You can see very easy. Patient was back to the food in the next day. And after 1 week, normal food. This is the cholecystectomy. I go to the other patient. The other patient is a young man with 28 years, with really severe dysphagia. Very like, looks like this lady. We make the dissection in the same way. In this patient, I use the scissor, the monopolar scissor. You can use the hook, Maryland bipolar, or you can use the scissor. But you need to do very careful movements like the brilliant presentations before, not to injure the mucosa. You see the aorta, the pericardium, really slow movements, very careful with the energy, low energy, not to injure the mucosa. This patient is presenting dysphagia during the last 1 year, and he lose 10 kilograms due to the dysphagia. You can see how easy it is to dissect the mucosa off the tumor and to cut the muscles. We are putting the tumor in position. You see, very easy to do. Really short cutting, really short cutting. And very low energy. It's only possible to do with the robot. With thoracoscopy, it could be really impossible to do this. You see, mucosa is behind, and now you cut all the muscles. You know the hole, remove the specimen, and then put again stitches to protect the mucosa. Patient was discharged after 1 day, and after 7 days, normal diet. You see, very easy. It's good to do all the esophageal surgeries, hiatal hernia, reoperative hiatal hernia, esophageal cancer with the robo before you try to do this. It's not so easy like it looks like. You can see. We put a drain to protect the region and remove the drain the next day after X-ray. All the patients are doing well, eating everything. So it's a great pleasure to be with you. And it's really good to see you, my friends, after one year. Thank you very much. And thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Antonio. Thank you. Very nice presentation. It's a pleasure also for me to see you and the other friends after more than one year during this very worldwide difficult era. So I can start the the session of a question and answers. A first observation about the presentation of Yael speaking about the use of the robot. I have seen in your presentation use the robot in every case because it's the only solution to achieve a good result also in difficult cases. I think it's very important because if you think to use the robot only in difficult cases, you can achieve the sufficient experience to approach the more difficult patient, the more difficult situation. Is the same observation of Antonio when Antonio specified that before approach robotic esophageal enucleation, you have to do surgery of gastroesophageal junction, you have to do esophagectomy because the robotic enucleation may be very difficult. For Yael, just a question, what is your policy in timing between radiotherapy and surgery. We discuss more and more this topic. We know very well the difficulty to approach mediastinal dissection in advanced cancer, especially after a lot of months after radiotherapy. So this is the first question. For Piero, I think we can go step by step. Jelle, what is this, your opinion about the timing?
Now, I think usually we would aim for 8 to 12 weeks after chemoradiotherapy. And if you wait longer, of course, the effect can still continue. So sometimes it gives a better tumor response, but somewhere there's a threshold and the mediastinum can really get inaccessible. It's you don't see the planes, and it can be a hostile environment if you wait a couple of months after chemoradiotherapy. So I think anywhere between 6 and 12 weeks would be fine for me. And after 12 weeks, I would still go for it, but I know it's going to be more challenging. And sometimes we more and more see patients that get chemoradiotherapy and then some sort of wait and see approach. And I'm not a big fan of this approach. Actually, I'm pretty much against it because you can never assess truly if there is residual tumor. But because some hospitals in our country adopt that approach now, mainly driven by the SANO trial that is from Rotterdam, we see patients after a year, and then you really get a tough operation and more complications, I think.
Yeah.
In case of injury of the trachea or bronchus during the dissection, what is your technical solution? You put stitches or you use a flap or other technical, what is your suggestion?
If I see it during operation, I would suture it. And the good thing is that afterwards, your omentoplasty will be on top of what you sutured.
Yeah.
So it's a pretty good augmentation of your suturing. And then I'm happy and you don't see problems. If you have a longer persisting fistula that you sometimes see, usually after esophagectomy, then I would also always put pericardium in the defect.
Yeah.
And then a muscle flap on top of it.
If I can step in the conversation, I think, first of all, congratulations, impressive experience, very good. But what do you think about Japanese side? Because you showed some images on the left side of the recurrent nerve. And so Japanese, they are almost doing, majority of them, they are doing routinely that kind of meticulous lymphadenectomy around the laryngeal nerves, right and then left. And do you think that we have enough evidence that we should go in that direction? What's your honest opinion in that?
I think it's a very good question. And my honest opinion is that I don't know. But I know that for type 1 tumors, we looked into our own database and we found 8% of paratracheal lymph node metastases. So we do find them. Same for the thoracic duct compartment, as Andrea commented about. It's lower, it's about 2%, but we find metastases. So I think if you want to do good surgery, those stations for me are part of routine dissection. But I must say the Japanese are impressive the way they do it. And they really do a very thorough, meticulous dissection of the upper mediastinum. Their rate of recurrent nerve injury is a bit higher. And I think their patient selection is also different because they usually have more squamous cell tumors, more higher up, and of course, thinner patients. So, but I must say, my friend Yinkai Chow from Taiwan, the way he does the recurrent nerve dissection, I can only dream of getting the same result in our patients, because they're much fatter and much more difficult to operate, I think.
Thank you. Yeah,
people that is doing that kind of meticulous dissection are using also nerve monitoring in the left vagus, and you already probably told something about that. Do you think might help in the, because you mentioned the palsy rate for that kind of lymphadenectomy is still impressively high, because in the range of 28-30% of patients, they have a palsy of the left.
I agree, and it can play a role. I think usually you can see it quite well, actually, as I demonstrated in those movies. So I rely on my eyesight more than on monitoring, but I know that some people are very happy that they monitor, and I think it can be a very good add-on, especially if you're in a learning curve of doing these dissections. And one of the publications you mentioned is from Taiwan, where they had a 30% recurrent nerve injury when they started doing it. But now they went down to under 10%, which is acceptable.
Also, a question, if you don't mind, Andrea, for you. I know that you will ask me some question, but I have a question for you first, because we are speaking by topics. Now we are speaking about esophagectomy, no? Yeah. So do you always start from the chest, or sometimes you start from the abdomen, the dissection? And because this is a teaching webinar, so how is your suggestion? When to get started from the abdomen and when to get started? Because honestly, mainly with the robot, the transhiatal exploration, you can reach up the pulmonary veins easily. And probably starting from the abdomen, sometimes mainly if you're doing an IV use, you can optimize the timing, because you do the dissection, you prepare the gastric conduit, and you, of course, understand the resectability from the transhiatal exploration. And then you turn the position, semi-prone position for the patient, and you do all the rest without going back and forth.
So I always change once in an operation. So if I do an Ivor Lewis, I will start in the abdomen. Yeah. If I do a McEwen, I'll start in the chest, and then do everything with the patient on his back with the neck anastomosis. But for Ivor Lewis, I always start in the abdomen. And I think it's a more fluent and efficient operation, Ivor Lewis. And it's only two stages and not the next stage. But I make my decision based on where the tumor is. And then I look at the radiation field, and I make sure that my anastomosis is never in that radiation field. So if the radiation field is under the level of the aortic arch, then I would go for the chest anastomosis. And if it's higher up, I would go to the neck. And in my practice, it's about 60% in the chest and 40% in the neck.
I have the same opinion. Usually for distal cancer, we plan Ivor Lewis esophagectomy. We start by abdominal step. We can check resectability, opening the hiatus. We can go inside the mediastinum up to the... Theoretically, we can perform lymph node dissection up to the carina. We have a very good vision. The lymphadenectomy above the carina may be difficult using the transhiatal way, but for the esophageal dissection, we can go up to the superior thoracic inlet. For other indication, McEwen, we start by the chest, also because the evaluation of the tumors of middle or superior esophagus is very important. So we have to approach surgery starting from the chest.
Well, what is interesting to comment on that is that we recently got some experience with transcervical esophagectomy. Yeah. So we start from the neck, put a port in, and then Dr. Robot, and then do a dissection of the posterior mediastinum from the neck, which reaches to the carina as well.
Yeah. Did you have an experience, Yael?
We did a lot of cadaver studies to get that experience, and we're now in the ethical approval process of doing it in patients. But we've done a series of, I think, 10 cadavers together with Peter Grimminger from Mainz, and he did some cases already.
Yeah. So we have to visit you in Utrecht for this technique.
There is a question from an attendee that is about risk of transhiatal herniation after esophagectomy. So it's a question for the panelists.
Yeah. What do you do? Honestly, I have operated for a lot of years. I have not experienced of herniation. The last years, I observed 3 patients with herniation inside the hiatus. So the suggestion is to opening the hiatus as minimum as possible. Because it may be a problem. Yella, I don't know your experience, but
we've looked into it, and it's about 7%, the rate of hernias. And we've done a study together with an English center, and we compared their open series to our robotic series, and it was the same. But there are also some reports that it might happen more often after minimally invasive surgery, because there are less adhesions and the liver is not so stuck on the hiatus. So maybe after minimally invasive surgery and robotic surgery, you will find more hernias. So ever since I found out that it was 7%, we started closing the hiatus routinely. And I think it's lower now, but I have to look into it again. I think we started closing it 3 years ago. And we should update our series.
But some Japanese surgeons, they are closing the hiatus and they are making the retrosternal route of the conduit. So just one of the risks. The other, of course, to avoid a complication of the gastric conduit in contact with the trachea or other intrathoracic and in a radiated field and so on. So what do you think about the strategy, closing the hiatus and putting the gastric conduit? The physiology of the emptying probably is not the best.
No, that's it. And I do that sometimes if you do, for instance, an acute resection for necrosis and then don't do a reconstruction. Then I use the substernal route, but I always think it's difficult to have enough space in the neck. You always have to resect the head of the clavicle. So it's a pretty big operation. And if you can just place it in primary surgery in the bed, I think it's more natural, more intuitive, more the way that you would like your esophagus to be in that esophageal bed. But for redo surgery, I think this route is a great route.
And then yes, I agree with Andrea. It's, 4 years, apparently, I had no complications in that, even though, let me say, if you're reviewing a follow-up CT scan, you see that sometimes they have herniations and they're probably asymptomatic. And I had a couple of cases. One in particular, I had to reoperate twice. And laparoscopically to reduce the colon that was herniated inside the chest. And to close the hiatus in this situation is always risky to injury the blood supply or the gastric conduit. And so I try to do some colopexy and using the omentum just to fix, but the patient had another recurrence that was symptomatic. So it's difficult to manage, and there are no standardized solution for that.
No, And it's always a big hole because it's all retracted because there's no anatomic integrity anymore. So it's always a big hole and it's hard to close. So I usually use a mesh to close it. And I'm not so afraid of a mesh on the stomach and on the gastric conduit, less afraid than on an esophagus. Then I'm a bit more worried about it.
Okay, so I have a few other questions about the leiomyotomy, because I did a beautiful presentation, Graziano, on that, and a wonderful experience, a nice video. But I have some concern about mobilizing the posteriorly the esophagus. I think it's not necessary to do that, and mainly with the robot. Probably laparoscopically, it was helpful, this maneuver of track down. But now with the robot, you can enter into the mediastinum for a long way, and you can do a nice anterior myotomy. And visualizing the vagal nerves perfectly, because I remember, I have to remind that the left is crossing very often the junction, so it's crossing the way you're doing the myotomy. So I have to visualize perfectly the main trunk and that. Do you have any comment on that? Oh, sure, you have a nice experience, but I would like to know also the opinion of the other panelists here. Do you routinely mobilize posteriorly the esophagus for the myotomy?
Yeah, the full mobilization is a matter of discussion. Every time I speak about myotomy, there is this kind of debate. And I think that there are schools or surgeons who are systematically mobilizing and someone is not systematically mobilizing. Personally, I systematically mobilize because I think that this is a good solution to expose, to correctly expose the esophagogastric junction. Esophagogastric junction is not every time into the abdomen. Sometimes it's higher, and I treated some advanced achalasia, and I think that in this case it's important to expose the part of the esophagus that is dilated. So it's important to recognize the point where the fibers are not closed. So I think it's important. And another consideration is about the vagal nerve, the anterior nerve, because in this way you can recognize the pathway and you can preserve the nerve. Sometimes we have the need to underpass the nerve to complete the myotomy, and in some cases where we proceed to the myotomy with the endoscopist in our operating room, we saw that the tract of spastic contraction of the circular fibers were longer and was and the end of our myotomy was higher than we expected before the operation. So I think that this is in my opinion, in my experience, a good maneuver without significant risks, and when it's completed correctly, exposing correctly the crus, I think that it's effective to recognize the end of the myotomy, more. I don't know what your opinion. What is your opinion of?
I think I started my experience in myotomy as explained. At the beginning, I mobilized the junction to track the esophagus by a loop. But honestly, during the year, I have changed, and so usually I don't mobilize completely the esophagus. The posterior mobilization Finally, I think can increase the risk of injuries of posterior vagal nerve or the posterior wall of the esophagus. Also, we have an increasing of operating time. So I suggest you to try, because frequently I think is a more a mental approach of a surgeon, but technically I think is not, we don't need the mobilization in every case. So I suggest to try, Graziano, because you can reduce also operating time for your patients. I have a question about the use of Indochinese green. It's very interesting, the use that you showed in your presentation. But my question is, really, you where is the incidence of microischemia in the mucosa after myotomy? Really, did you observe microischemia in some cases, and where is your technical solution? You resect the mucosa with microischemia and you shoot, or what is the solution in case of microischemia of the mucosa after myotomy?
Andrea, it's really an initial experience, so I'm just observing what is occurring. I think that one of the risk of the myotomy when you use the hook to lift up and to coagulate the fibers is to propagate the energy or the color of the instrument to the mucosa. So I'm trying to see that if this is true or not. Probably a small incidence of perforation is not during the operation. There are cases of late perforation, and I think that probably this is the mechanism to determine the perforation, the late perforation. So we have a really low incidence of perforation in robotic surgeries, probably because the maneuver is more precise, because the visualization is more detailed. So probably in robotic surgery we have not this problem. But I think that if we want to try to have an enhanced recovery in this patient, we have to be sure that there is no any risk of late perforation. So I think that this is a simple tool which doesn't cause any elongation of the operative time. I think it's useful. It's interesting to study this kind of use to improve not only the technical aspects, but the post-operative aspect, to shorten the post-operative stay and to give food to this patient very early after the operation with minimal risk.
It's a very interesting approach, and you have a very scientific mind, and I know you for a long time. And but of course you're assuming that those lesions are micro ischemic, and usually micro ischemia it works after 3-4 days. That's in colon surgery, no? When we have perforation, it takes some time to have a necrosis and the perforation. So I think the mechanism of the few, like now we are discussing about 0.1 perforation, are probably mechanical, and there is a micro tear. And when you have some forces in the post-op, like vomitus or nausea or straining of the abdomen, and so you have an increased pressure there, and there is a micro tear. That my opinion is that, because usually perforation that are reported are very early perforation that happens in the first 24 hours. And so it's an interesting idea, and I agree, keep making the observation from a scientific point of view, but I doubt that you will get any useful information for that.
We have to try, we have to try.
We need 100,000 patients.
Okay, when I reach 100, we will
with the perforation rate of 0.1, I think that to have a significant number of observations, it's an enormous number. But, okay.
Yeah, you have a comment, a question about the myotomy, Antonio?
Are you asking me?
No,
Dr. Macedo. Ah, okay.
Antonio Macedo. Antonio Ayel,
yes.
Do you have a question about the Ehlers myotomy?
No, no. I use only the cutting energy to cut the fibers. I never use the coagulation energy. I think the use of cutting energy is more easy to cut without to injure the mucosa. And I always put a door in the front of the myotomy.
I fully agree with what is said. And I think that the perforations are truly usually surgical damages rather than microvascularization problems. The vascularization is in the mucosa, it's still good. So I think what Professor Giulianotti commented about that makes sense. And I think if you have some mechanical problems like vomiting combined with a very small injury, that's usually the 0.1%. And it's so seldom in robotic surgery that it's gonna be very hard to do studies on that topic, but it will give information anyway. I agree.
Yeah, I would like to add some consideration briefly that when you have a small perforation, I didn't have any perforation, but when you use an induction in green on the stump of the aniviscus, you have an outflow of induction in the operative field. So I think that even in case of microperforation, ICG could be useful, not because you see an ischemic area or a hyperperfusion, but because you can see induction in green flowing out the mucosal layer. So I think that we have to study. I think that this is a tool to have an improved visualization of the mucosa. I don't know if it's really useful, but I think it's interesting to explore the use of induction in green or other tool we have available thanks to the robotic platform in various scenarios to test them and to evaluate their utility.
But sorry, I don't know if I misunderstood, but are you injecting the ICG through the NG or IV?
IV.
I don't think you can see the ICG coming out of the lumen or the, if it's IV, it's IV.
But if you have a tear or a perforation of the mucosa,
you bleed. If it's bleeding with the blood is coming out, because if it's a IV injection, there is no ICG in the lumen, so you cannot see something going out of the lumen of the esophagus because there is nothing inside. This is why I'm asking, are you injecting endoscopically with the NG? This is another story, but IV, I don't think you can see anything coming out of that. But let me make another comment on this, because it's a didactical point. What is the natural side effect of the Ehlers myotomy?
To me?
Yes. What is the natural side effect of the Ehlers myotomy?
Simple, myotomy is a gastroesophageal reflux.
Yes, this is the reflux. So, and we are using the door that is a partial protection, And I remember that the door never is covering the entire area of the myotomy, because a perfectly done myotomy is long inside the chest. So the door is covering only the distal portion and the gastric portion of the myotomy in some way. That's protection reflux, it's 70%, 60-70%. It's not that protection. But if you mobilize the posterior wall, you in some way weaken a mechanism that is anchoring the abdominal esophagus in place. And the esophagus, you know, there are longitudinal fibers that tends to contract and retract, contract and retract. So if you're mobilizing the posterior part, you're disanchoring the esophagus and tends to become more intrathoracic. With the intrathoracic junction and distal esophagus, you have a more reflux. This is another reason that convinced me to avoid to touch the posterior anchoring system of the esophagus and just to do the anterior.
I agree with you, but I told that this is a matter of debate. And I know important centers who are continuing to fully mobilize the esophagogastric junction. In our experience, we didn't see an increase of gastroesophageal reflux, to be honest, but it can be a suggestion to modify or to explore another kind approach. I think that in severe achalasia, we tend to treat patients with severe achalasia with EGA score of third stadium, so with high scores. I think that the absence of peristalsis in the esophagus probably decreases this kind of movement of the esophagus that is a peristaltic movement. I don't know, but In our experience, we have not evidence of increased reflux. I will explore, because I am really interesting on your observation. I told before that you are my master, so I'm really really sensible on this kind of suggestion, and from Andrea and from Jelle. I thank you.
you are a wonderful surgeon. And probably you learn from me the wrong way, because I remember years ago I was doing that kind of posterior mobilization.
I mean, in the old era.
I needed to apologize with you.
the last topic, the robotic enucleation of benign tumor of the esophagus. I have a question for Antonio. Did you use intraoperative ultrasound to check the position of the tumor, to check the limits? Because I have used the intraoperative robotic ultrasound. I think it's very useful. Also, in order to avoid endoscopy, because in some cases endoscopy may be mandatory, but I think using the intra-robotic ultrasound, the robotic probe that surgeon can control by the console, we can avoid the use of esophagoscopy, intraoperative esophagoscopy. What do you think about this?
I think ultrasound is a very good help to us, not only in pancreatic surgery, where I use routinely, but in esophageal surgery, I use also ultrasound through the table of the patient. I think ultrasound is very good. I don't think it's necessary to use endoscopy if you localize with the ultrasound where is the tumor. I think if you have a doubt about a lesion in the mucosa, it's very difficult to put an injury in the mucosa, because the mucosa is very easy to be free of the muscles. But I agree with you. In all the surgeries, the ultrasound system is beside the worst for if necessary, I use also.
I have a question, if I may ask. You showed the left chest approach of these distal myomas. And in our experience, and we did many cases of that, there are two groups, and cases that you need to go in the right chest because they are in the middle and of the esophagus. But the lesions that are in the distal and they can be accessed transiatally. So I never approach from the left side, because what you can do from the left can be done from transiatally. So either or you have to go in the right chest, or if you have to make an approach from the left chest, the same approach can be done transiatally. And I think the advantage of doing it transiatally, you're avoiding double lumen, possibility of leaving a chest tube, a complication in the chest, that anything can be done. And another important step that you can do from the abdomen, and usually when you're doing myotomy, you're afraid of perforation in the post-op. So it might be prudent, mainly when the dissection is in the distal esophagus, to prolong the myotomy and to do a kind of Eller myotomy to decrease the pressure of the sphincter and to protect the distal part with the door anti-reflux. So I think the transiatal approach is allowing a more complex, tailored solution for the case.
I have two cases I present to you. And in these two cases, the dissection was really easy, no problem. And I put stitches into the muscles. So I think it's a good option to do through the left side. You go to the lesion, remove the lesion, and you suture the muscles. But I agree with you, it's possible to do to the transabdominal. You put the esophagus into the abdomen, in the lower part, and remove the lesion. But I think it's too easy into the thorax, but too easy. I think you need to try, because it's really easy.
I tried it a couple of times for redo fundoplications. So if you have a fourth or fifth redo, you have to access, you don't have access from the hiatus, then I sometimes take the left chest, and then I take left, because usually they go to the left, the recurrent hernias, because on the right side there's the liver and you don't have too much problem. And then you can do like a Belzy procedure from the left chest with the robot, and you can push the stomach back into the abdomen. That's for me. I think I showed one of the very seldom cases, but usually I do everything to the right chest as well.
Other question, other comments?
I would like to ask you, Yalen, Andrea, and Piero, what is your strategy in the management of fistulas? Because Ivor Lewis especially remains competing with high fistula rates. And I would like to know what is your strategy if you prevent fistulas in any way, and how do you treat fistulas?
The strategy is to search to avoid fistula. It was a real problem. We can discuss one day about the problem of fistulas, but I think...
How does this or aspiration or drain?
I think the first suggestion is to search early the fistula, because we have after this kind of surgery, we have a particular attention, a particular care to our patient. It's very important to search the fistula from the first hour after surgery when the patient doesn't work, because in some cases the first clinical appearance of a fistula may be only the PCR high, maybe atrial fibrillation, maybe everything outside of normal post-operative course. So we have to search the fistula, even performing endoscopy. The endoscopy is very important. You can do CT scan by gastrographing, but the endoscopy is very important because you can check the real status of the gastric conduit. You can confirm the fistula, you can confirm the ischemia or good perfusion of the conduit. This is a very important point for the next approach to treat the fistula. In general, we prefer a conservative management using it depends of the cases, using endoscopic or a radiological solution. I think surgery, if we have not an ischemia of the conduit, we have we leave the surgical solution as the last post-technical possibility. I don't know, Yael, what is your opinion, but I think now today the conservative management is the more used, the more important.
I think I've got two or three things to comment next to what you were saying, because I totally agree. One is intraoperative ICG use really helps, I think, that you always know that your anastomosis is in a very well vascularized area of the gastric conduit. So that's one. And the second thing that really helps is the omentoplasty. So if you have a leak, it will be a contained leak because it's within the omentoplasty. And then for me, I would treat it exactly the same, do an early endoscopy and then put a naso gastric tube in it. Some people advocate vacuum sponges, but I just use a normal nasogastric tube and put mild suction on it. And the advantage of a normal tube over a vacuum sponge is that you don't have to change it every 3 days. So it's much easier in the management. And I think that's the way I would treat it usually. Yeah. An interesting thing we're doing right now is that we know these people that have a lot of calcifications in their arteries. We've published a couple of papers on that. And they are at much higher risk because they have vascular disease for a leak. And in those patients, what we do now, and we study it together with the University of Cologne in Germany, is that we precondition the gastric conduits. So we go in, do a diagnostic laparoscopy 2 weeks prior to the esophagectomy, and we already clip the left gastric, and we already take the short gastric arteries. So we already give some ischemia to the stomach. And then we think that that might also prevent the leakages.
A particular problem may be the hepatic cirrhosis, hepatic or chronic hepatitis with portal hypertension, because we know the problem of portal hypertension. We have an increased risk of ischemia of gastric conduit. We increase the complications. So what is your policy, in Utrecht, for chronic hepatopathy or cirrhosis? You avoid surgery, you put tips. I have operated a patient putting tips before surgery with a very perfect post-operative course, maybe away. What is your opinion?
We had a patient like that last week in our MDT, and we said the patient had the tips this week, and now we'll get the chemo radiotherapy. And then afterwards, we will try to operate. But I think it's extremely challenging and dangerous surgery. If the patient has one complication, they're at serious risk of not surviving. And so the patient really has to be very motivated, otherwise fit. And otherwise, I would try to not perform surgery on such a patient. But sometimes you just have to. And then a tips will reduce the amount of blood loss that you will face.
Okay. Okay. I think we can close the meeting. Piero?
No. I will say that they are calling me. They've received already.
Okay.
I think we are far beyond our planned schedule for the webinar. So there are so many interesting topics and mainly complications. They would require a special session just for that. And dealing is like asking how you treat a complication of a leak, as how do you do with a failing marriage? There are hundreds of thousands of different situations. Which kind of leak? How is the patient? Is septic? Is stable? Is a minor leak? There is ischemia involved, but there is no ischemia. Where is this leak in contact with the trachea? Omentoplasty, it could help, but also a contained perforation of the conduit close to the trachea can maybe a month later perforate into the trachea. I saw a complication that with delayed drainage of an abscess, contained abscess into the trachea. And I can guarantee that it's a difficult situation to manage. So it's such a complex topic that would require, a dedicated session. And because the panelists of today have been such a great panelist, congratulations for all. We can make an official promise to organize soon another one, maybe focusing on a more detailed topic that could be how we treat the complication or how we technically do something that you mentioned, even the preconditioning of the gastric conduit is a very interesting topic that I really like.
I look forward to the next one. A great, great session. And I enjoyed seeing all your movies and all the great comments. So I look forward to the next one.
Okay, fantastic. Yes.
Okay. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you to everybody. Thank you to CRSA for this opportunity. I'm happy of this webinar. It was very interesting. And probably, according to Piero, we can organize other webinar in a specific topic of esophageal surgery. So I hope to see you in a brief future, to see in person. Probably, I hope to visit Yale in Utrecht. I promised you to visit some years ago, but we work too much, Yale.
That's it. But I have to visit you as well.
Okay.
Looks beautiful behind you.
Thank you.
Okay. It's a fake landscape. It's a
I know.